Good morning. You notice my card keeps getting smaller. It's because I keep doing writing it, trying to reuse the same card. So want the thumbnail of the videos to have this image on it. So there we go. Hey, sorry I got started a little bit late. Facebook has a new cool live stream thing, and I don't know how to use it, so I just switched to the old version. Ricky Parker? What? Hey, man. Glad you're here. Brennan, good to see you. I'll see you at like 2:30 today. That's exciting. Couple announcements coming up. The camera's backwards, so it's hard for me to. Okay. Beautiful. Coffee. Hey, for those of you Bear Creek people that don't know Ricky Parker, he is the youth pastor at Alameda Baptist Church in Norman, Oklahoma, and he's doing a really good job there. He just one of my good friends, and we talk ministry all the time. And he's, I think, Ricky, did you get the Zoom thing worked out? Where you're gonna Zoom the youth? Is that still in the works? In the comments. Good morning, Heather. We're feeding our baby now with like sweet potatoes and oatmeal and stuff, and it's the cutest thing ever. Hey, Josh, what's up, man? Anyway, I'll Holden, what's up? Cool. Couple announcements for Bear Creek Springs Baptist Church. Still working on it. Cool. Couple announcements. Today we are going to be live streaming from. This is for the youth group. Today we're going to be live streaming from First Baptist Church Valley Springs, and it's going to be me and a couple other youth ministers from around. I'll be doing worship. I'll be playing music. If it's worship or not depends on your heart, because you guys know. But anyway, I'll be playing some songs. We'll do some games. We'll have a roundtable discussion. We're going to be talking about Bible verses and stories that give us hope, and should be a good time. We're going to put links in all of our social medias to link you over to First Baptist Valley Springs live stream at 3 o'clock. The way that we're probably going to replay it about 6 o'clock, because that's the time the youth are used to getting coming to church. So live stream at 3, probably replayed at 6, and we'll get it out on all of the social medias. Our YouTube channel is Bear Creek Springs Baptist. No, Bear Creek Baptist Church AR. You can search that, Bear Creek Baptist Church AR. And Facebook, you're obviously here. So there you go. So check us out, and we'll have links on our personal accounts and the Bear Creek Springs Baptist Church group account and 242 Student Ministries. So check us out on that. Thank you for tuning in. Thanks for hanging out with us today. I hope the comment section is a place where we get to interact, where we can't be, hugging and shaking hands right now this morning, but we can interact in the comments. So please do that. We're working on Sunday to have a live stream going on YouTube. We did last week. It cut out a couple times. The reason for that was we were just trying to push way too much stuff through a small converter box. So that will be remedied. So we'll be on YouTube. We're gonna have a link from Facebook over to there. And again, use the comments to interact with each other as best we can. Couple other things to be thinking about. If you do not have the YouVersion, YOU version Bible app on your phone, I would encourage you. Air hug. Thanks, buddy. I would encourage you to get that, the YouVersion app, because you can link with other people. Hey, man. You can link with other people on the app. So you could search Kyle Guyman. and find me on the YouVersion Bible app, and then we could connect. And as I'm reading through a Bible study, you could be seeing my progress, I could see your progress, and we could connect that way. So the YouVersion Bible app, pretty cool stuff. Ironically, it's not on my phone right this minute. I had to delete it so that I could put another app on there, but anyway, that will be getting back on my phone soon. So let's dive right in to our study. We have been going through the book of John, starting in chapter 10. We're going to be trying to go through 17, and we're using a Bible method that was given to me by a guy, and I've kind of filled it out, and it's called SOAP. SOAP. We look at the scripture and ask good questions about that. We make observations. We try to apply it to our lives, and at the end we pray. And I have these packets. We give these out in our members class, and it kind of describes the Bible study method, just a method. There's lots of you can look at. You can do it however you like. Praise God for that. But inside that packet, I've taken the book of John, just cut and paste it, and then add a section for notes. So if you want this packet emailed to you, let me know in the comments, and we can connect. Hi, Taylor. No, it's great. And Angel, hi, Angel. So we're just going to be looking at John chapter 11 this morning, and we're going to read top to bottom and then break it into some chunks and try to hey Ashley, hey, we're going to try to just see what God has for us today through this. And this really isn't meant to be taking place of your personal quiet time, the personal time you spend with God. But what we do want to do with this is have kind of a scripture that we're all talking about, we're all connecting with in the comments, and stuff. So before I read this text, I want to pray Psalms. Wow, blanked. The prayer that we always pray at the beginning. Then we'll dive into the text. So let me pray for us real quick. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. God, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for your word. And I pray that as we study it, God, that we would just fall deeper in love with you. God, that as we experience your words that were written so long ago, God, they would just speak to us in a new and exciting way. Even if we know the story of Lazarus, God, I pray that you would just use it to equip us and encourage us for the work that you have for us right now today. It's in your precious name we pray all these things. Amen. All right. A man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. This is Mary, who later poured expensive perfume on the Lord's feet and wiped it with her hair. Her brother, Lazarus, was sick. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, "Lord, your dear friend is very sick." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this." So although Jesus loved Martha and Mary and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. Finally, he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." But the disciples objected. "Teacher," they said, "only a few days ago, people in Judea were trying to stone you. Are we going to go back there again?" So actually, let's do this study a little bit different today. Instead of reading the whole thing, we'll just read it in chunks and kind of talk about it. So whenever we read through using the SOAP Bible study method, we look at the scripture, we look at the context of the scripture, we look at the author, and try to ask some good questions so we can get a good idea of what's going on here. John chapter 9, Jesus has healed a man who was born blind. This man was lost like a sheep without a shepherd. John chapter 10, Jesus establishes, "I am the good shepherd." Then here in chapter 11, we see that Jesus has a personal friend who is sick, Lazarus. And so In this first section, we see the tension kind of build. Lazarus, who Jesus loved, and his sisters, Mary and Martha, who Jesus loved, they send a message that Lazarus is sick. And Jesus knows the outcome of this. He knows how it's all going to work out. But that doesn't mean that the people here on earth know exactly how it's going to work out. Mary and Martha are going to be worried and upset. Jesus knows this, but a verse that we can zoom in on is verse 4. This is going to happen so that for the glory of God, that God may receive glory from this. Right now, we don't understand everything. There's a lot of weird stuff going on. The government is making some great decisions and maybe some decisions we don't agree with. There's a lot of things that are out of our control. But a good question to ask in this situation is, can God use this for his glory? And the answer is absolutely. God can use this for his glory. The question is, how is he going to use this for his glory? And so with this Mary and Martha today in the story in chapter 11 to verse 8, they're going through a rough time. They know their brother is sick. And so they are suffering. They're in pain. They want to see God do something big, like right now. Because that would make sense. In the text, we've already seen Jesus has immediately healed people. And that's probably what they were expecting. Hey, we'll just send a messenger to Jesus. Jesus will say, oh yeah, I love these guys. Boom, you're healed. And Lazarus immediately, supernaturally is healed immediately, and good, let's get on with our day. But that's not how God chose to let this play out. God knew it was going to be for his glory. We as Christ followers have to trust that everything can work for the good of those who love God, Romans 8:28. But we see the tension in the first part of 11 building, that Jesus has this problem, these people he loved, Lazarus is sick, and there's also the tension of even going to visit Lazarus could result in their death. Verse 8, great practical question. Only a few days ago, the people of Judea were trying to stone you. They were trying to kill you. So we're going to go back to that place? The place where they were trying to kill you? There's kind of a rough proposition. Let's jump down to verse 9. Jesus replied, he gives a parable here. There's 12 hours of daylight every day. During the day, people can walk safely. They can see because they have the light of this world. But at night, there's a danger of stumbling because they have no light. So here Jesus is kind of explaining. He's established himself as the light of the world. And as his disciples are in a time of, they're scared, Jesus, who narrowly escaped death last chapter, is now going to go back to the same area where they were picking up rocks to kill Jesus. And Jesus gives them this word of comfort. Now, it's a little cryptic, but here's the basic parable. If a guy walks around in the light, he's good. He has light. If the guy walks around in the dark time, he might fall down because it's dark. So what's the parallel here between the disciples' discomfort, the disciples' legitimate fear, and what Jesus is trying to tell them? Well, Jesus is the light of the world. We find encouragement in Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight. So he'll make your path good. He'll make your path where it can be navigated. So he's using this image of light, him being the light of the world. We know that Psalms 119:105 says, the word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. But this idea of a lamp, it's very different than a flashlight. A flashlight, I can click on and I can see all around. With a lamp, you hold it close and it only illuminates what is close. So a mentor of mine once said that God's word, God, the Holy Spirit gives us the next step. If you've ever been camping with just a lamp, you can see a couple steps ahead, but that's it. So if I truly want to see the next step, I have to take the next step. For Jesus is the light of the world. His word is a lamp to my feet. I need to, in all my ways, acknowledge him so he can make my path straight, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. But if I want to experience that, I have to take that next step. Because until I take that next step, that lamp will not illuminate what's next. Jesus does not give us a map and say, go here, go here, go here. Jesus is more of a compass that says, head in this direction. This is what is good. This is the right path. And as you take those steps, you see more of what God's will for you is. Like Jonah getting swallowed up by the whale, or excuse me, the large fish is a better translation. Jonah was headed the wrong direction, and he kind of hit a wall. And that's where the blessings of God stopped. Well, he didn't hit a wall. He hit a big fish. Jonah was going the wrong direction, and everything stopped. Until he repented, and then he was given the next step at the next step and go into the city and preach repentance and then go on the mountain and watch the city, and they repented to his dismay. And his relationship with God was growing, and it was uncomfortable sometimes, but that's growth. So, John chapter 11, verse 9, Jesus is the light of the world, and as we stick with Jesus, he's going to give us illumination. As we trust in Jesus, as we have faith in Jesus, and we make those steps in faith, he illuminates the next step for us. Verse 11, then he said, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I'm going to go wake him up. Verse 12, the disciple said, look, if Lazarus is sleeping, won't he get better? They thought Jesus meant Lazarus was simply asleep, but Jesus meant Lazarus was dead. Verse 14, so Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I'm glad I wasn't there, for now you will really believe. Come, let us go see him. As you read really good books about Christian apologetics, and I'll show you one. Oh, I totally don't have it. Weak. Where? Oh, it's over there. Anyway, excuse me. Earthquake. All right. This book, More Than a Carpenter, is a really good book on what the big church word, Christian apologetics. And so it gives a defense for the faith. An apologetics means to give a reason for. And so More Than a Carpenter is a good book. Also, I have a case of these. And so if you are interested, once we get back to church as normal, come shake my hand, and I can give you one of these. The church paid for them. So if you're a part of Bear Creek Springs Baptist Church, come grab a book. You already paid for it through your tithes and such. So I have a case of these in the youth room if you want one. But what this does is it walks through what makes Jesus different, what makes Jesus special. Was he really God in the flesh? Well, yes, but how do you defend that? Well, lots of things in here talk about that. One of the good arguments for defending our faith is that the Bible shows all of the bad stuff too. What I mean is, if I was going to start a new religion, okay, and I was going to make a text for that new religion, I was going to establish, this is the history of the leadership of this new religion. I was going to establish, this is the character of these new religious leaders. I would not include things like this, what we just read. The disciples said, well, if he's sleeping, let's let him sleep. He's sick. That'll be good. But Jesus said to them plainly, what I meant was he's dead. So in this text, and it's okay, the disciples look like idiots because they didn't get it. If I was going to establish a brand new world religion, I would not have the founders of that religion, the original apostles, look like idiots over and over and over in the text. But that's what we see here. Over and over and over, they say dumb things. So, and this also establishes the miracle that Jesus, in the next tomorrow, when we're going to look at, as Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, that's a miracle. But also, Jesus knew that Lazarus was dead. Jesus supernaturally knew that he wasn't just sick, that he had already passed away. He had already died. And so, Jesus here is, we know that Jesus is God, but this is further enforcing the fact that he knows what's going on. He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. And he knows that Lazarus has, in fact, died. And he also knows that his disciples are pretty dense and they don't understand. And so, again, if I was going to establish a new religion, I wouldn't put things like this in the text. But why are they there? Because it's true. Because that's what happened. So, there it is. It's honest. Cool part, verse 16. There was a man named Thomas, whose nickname was the twin, and this is his response to what Jesus said. Remember, we're going to go see Lazarus. Oh, isn't that the town where they tried to kill you like a couple days ago? Jesus says, yeah, let's go. So this is Thomas's response. Let us go too, that we may die with Jesus. Now the name Thomas might sound familiar because this is the same Thomas who after the resurrection wanted proof that Jesus had raised from the dead. The other apostles who were also disciples, they saw the risen Lord Jesus, and Thomas comes in and says, I want proof. So Thomas is he gets a bad rap being called Doubting Thomas. But we see his character in this verse. Verse 16, he was willing to go. He made the declaration. Well, if Jesus is going to die, let's go. Let's go die with him. His faith in Jesus, his loyalty to Jesus is intense. We can learn something from that. His loyalty with Jesus is super intense. And that's why, I believe, whenever the apostles said they saw Jesus, he wanted proof. He doubted their claim because it meant so much to him. He wanted proof. He wanted to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. And when Jesus does appear to Thomas and he says, hey, look, here's the holes. You can put your hands in the holes of my hands and my feet. And Thomas falls to his knees and makes a declaration, my Lord and my God. Thomas exclaims that Jesus is not only powerful or not only a Lord, but he is in fact God in the flesh. And at that time, God resurrected in the flesh. So Thomas is a really important eyewitness to all these things that are happening. And his faith should be encouraging to all of us. Let's go to and die with him. That's great. Verse 17, last section, John chapter 11, verse 17. When Jesus arrived at Bethany, he was told Lazarus had already been in the grave 4 days. Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem. God don't waste no ink. Heard that from a good friend. God don't waste no ink. Why would they put that in there in verse 18? Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem. So Jesus was a few miles away. Jesus could have left at any time to go see Lazarus to heal him. Jesus could have healed him even without being physically there. We see him do this. So could Jesus have walked a couple miles and fixed this situation for Mary and Martha? Yes. Could Jesus have done it without even physically being there? Yes. But Jesus established before this even got started, this whole scenario was for his glory. Was Mary and Martha hurting? Yes. But did Jesus have bigger plans? Plans that they couldn't even comprehend? Yeah. Back to the text, verse 19. And many of the people had come to console Mary and Martha in their loss. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to him, but Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus, 21. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. Martha has great faith. She understands that Jesus could have prevented her brother from dying. Sure. And now she's kind of hinting at, verse 22, even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus knows what Martha wants. She wants her brother back. Before his glory, he's allowing this event to happen. We're going to talk more tomorrow, and these videos are Monday through Thursday, and so tomorrow will be our last installment for this week. But hey, Quincy. So we're going to talk more about the setting and kind of what it would sound like, what it would feel like, what it would smell like being at this tomb and seeing what Jesus did. But I want to kind of jump down to some observations. Jesus is, as he establishes the light to our path, we talked about Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trusting in Jesus and all of our ways, acknowledging him in, he'll make our path straight, which is really, really hard to trust in Jesus in all of our ways, arguably impossible, but we can move in that direction. Like I said, Christians are not the ones who never speed. We're the ones who realize we're speeding and we slow down. Another observation I wrote down is that Jesus can use all things for his glory. Romans 8, 28. God works together all things for the good of those who love him. There are promises in God's word for the Christian, for the Christ follower. But if you don't have a personal relationship with Christ, these promises are not for you. I could say that I could write a will and say that all of my children will equally divide up my inheritance when I pass away. That is a specific contract with a specific group of people. Okay? Right now on this earth, there's only one beautiful little girl named Lily Grace that is going to receive an inheritance from me. Now, if I have more kids, that would be divided up between those kids. But that is a legal document between me and my children. In God's word, we see there are promises for God's children. We talked about yesterday that we're all creations of God. God created all of us. But to be called a child of God, we need a personal relationship with Jesus. So what does that look like? And I'm going to be saying some things that most of us know, but that we definitely need to be reminded of, is that God made everything perfect. The Garden of Eden was perfect. God had perfect relationship with humanity. But part of creating a perfect being in Adam and Eve is giving them free will, giving them a choice. God didn't create robots. He created us perfectly in his image with free will. So if we choose to sin, then we have that option. So Adam and Eve chose to sin, and that sin separated them from God. God is perfect. He lives in a perfect place called heaven, and sin cannot enter that perfect place. We have a rug in our living room. It's white, and that's where Lily plays, and that is a special place, a set-apart place. We don't wear shoes on the rug because we want that to be clean and for her to be able to play on. Now, if you walked into my house and you had muddy boots on, I would say, okay, that's not nice, but sure. But if you tried to get on my baby's clean rug with your muddy boots, I would say, no, you got to take those off. We don't allow those muddy boots on our clean rug where my daughter plays. It's not because I don't like you. It's because that place is set apart. It is special. And so you can come onto the carpet, but you're going to have to leave the mud off the carpet because it is a special place. Jesus invites us to join him in a place called heaven, but we can't get in with our sins. So here's the issue. He loves us, but we can't enter because of our sin. So Jesus paid the ultimate price on the cross to offer us an opportunity to receive forgiveness of those sins, not just those sins being washed away, but those sins being obliterated and forgotten forever. So then we can enter the perfect place called heaven. So if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead, we will be saved. We will be given the right to be called children of God. And when we pass away, whether it be from some virus or some car wreck or some cancer or some whatever, we have confidence that we'll spend forever with God in heaven. And that is the best thing, this side of heaven that we can receive. And if you would like to hear more about my testimony, which isn't that great, but God does amazing things, we did a Sunday school video, a grow group video last week. It's on the Facebooks. And in there, I share my testimony, and a couple of my dear friends share their story of how they met Jesus as well. So let's land the plane. We're a little bit over 30 minutes. How do we apply this text to our life? Looking at our SOAP method, how do we use what we've learned today for today? And I wrote down in my notes that we should ask God to use our special circumstances for his glory. Mary and Martha didn't see the end of the road. They didn't know how this was going to turn out. But we know that God had a plan. We know that Martha showed great faith in saying that if you were here, my brother would have not died, but even now, God will give you whatever you ask. She knew that Jesus was in control, even though in her own world, it looked pretty chaotic. We know that Jesus is in control. And we also know that today we have an opportunity to do things that have never been done before. We know that today, for the first time in human history, the world altogether is looking for answers for a problem that we've never had. People are in their homes. People are more willing to answer the phone than ever before, right now, because they're stuck in their house. More willing to engage in social media, more willing to engage in like answer emails, and all those things, because we're all kind of stuck. So I would encourage you to think about your special circumstances, your specific group of friends on the social medias, your specific list of names and numbers in your phone, maybe a struggle that you're specifically going through. If you're battling with loneliness right now, you're not alone. Lots of people are. If you are battling with depression, like clinical depression, now would be a great time to reach out to other friends that you have that you know are in the same boat. If you're struggling with a job situation, there's plenty of other people out there that are struggling with that too. So that unique situation might be a way for you to dive into a conversation with somebody, and see how God is going to use that specific situation for his glory. And the fun part is, I don't know what that looks like for you. I know the principles, the foundation that God loves you and that God has a plan for you and that God earnestly desires to use your life to bring glory to him. And that's not selfish. His glory is for our good. And so we're doing what we were designed to do, to bring glory to God, because he's the one that made us. And so I would encourage you guys to ask the question, how can you use your specific circumstances? And I don't know what those are today for God's glory. And I don't know what that looks like, but we can talk about that tomorrow. Hey, let me end today's lesson, talk, whatever, the same way I have last week, by reading through Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9. And if you'd like, sometime I can go through and break this down a little bit more. Brother Mark actually used this sermon, preached a sermon over this text last Sunday. So if you want to check out our live stream from last Sunday, he goes over Philippians 4, 6, and 7 and does a great job. Also on the live stream, we have music, and there's a goofy guy in a plaid shirt who does announcements at the beginning. Please ignore that. But after that, it gets good. So let's read Philippians 4, 4 through 9. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, because the Lord is near. And don't be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put these things into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Amen." Hey, thanks for doing this with me. I've enjoyed hanging out. We're going to keep these videos going indefinitely, and we'll see you tomorrow to look at the second part of John chapter 11, the raising to life of Lazarus, and we'll have a good time. It's good to hang out with you all today. See you tomorrow. End live video. Click. Okay, do you want to end this video? If this end the video now, you'll be able to choose. Okay. And bye.